Sailam to everybody. We pronounce the lotus feet of Bhagavan. We welcome you all to this morning session. This is the fourth in the series of our Thursday talks. For information, in addition to Sunday talks there in the Mandir conference hall at 10:30, in response to some of our friends, we decided to have the second satsang also during the week, and they all decided Thursday. So as per their decision, this is the fourth Thursday of our meeting. We thank Bhagavan for bringing you all here to this morning. I sincerely believe that we don't do anything on our own accord, and we don't go anything anywhere on our accord. It is He that prompts, that wills, that sends, that brings all the success as He decides. Well, my friends, in our lifetime, there are moments when we feel lonely, when we feel lonely, alone, in the midst of the family, in the midst of position, politics, crowds, yet we feel lonely, as if I am unwanted, as if nobody wants me, as if I have no one else. So this loneliness is something that bothers everybody at some stage or other, in some moment or other, in the course of the day, at some moment of life, loneliness. To come out of this loneliness, what do? We seek another company, which is no solution. To get out of this loneliness, we try for some other job, no solution. The more we want them, the more lonely we are. The answer is this. When I go to a movie, or when I talk to a person, I am in a group. I feel I am comfortable. I am not lonely. It only means that loneliness is suppressed, that's all. There is loneliness there which is suppressed in unconscious state. The mind has three levels: the unconscious state, subconscious state, and the conscious state, the three levels. This loneliness is suppressed in the unconscious state, and it may crop up any moment. It will draw us into loneliness at any point of time. Also engages, also give us happiness, but that's not real. That is not true. That is not lasting. On the other hand, sometimes we are in a blissful state, imaginary blissful state. It is only mental projection of God. The imagination, mental projection of God. That's what happens out of emotion. But we have not come out of that loneliness anyway. So what is to be done, my friends? We should stop feeling that we should attain God. We should stop feeling that we should reach God. We should stop feeling that we should go to God. Attaining God, reaching God, going to God are meaningless. Are meaningless. There cannot be greater joke than that. There is no other thing that's more ridiculous than that. Because God is within you, and as Baba says, you are God. And when I say I should attain God, means what? When you are God, if I say I should reach God, means what? When I say I should go to God, means what? So going, reaching, attaining have no meaning when once we realize that every one of us is basically, fundamentally divine in our nature, divine in the making, divine in the built-up, divine in the makeup, divine in composition. That's what Baba says. So what should I do now? To realize that I am God, to know that I am God, what am I to do? There is nothing like doing here. We should give up all imaginations. We have got so many imaginations. People go on speaking that and that, that's all. Some imaginations. We should shed all our ideologies, all our thoughts, all our concepts. Concepts, thoughts, ideas, ideologies, they're all psychological, born of the mind. But God is beyond the mind. When God is beyond the mind, what is the fun of ideas? What is the fun of ideologies? Why concepts? What is a dream? What is a hallucination? These are all mental projections. These are all psychological. Therefore, renunciation, vairagya, renunciation is nothing but shedding, giving up, to dispense with, to eliminate, to do away with ideas, ideologies, concepts, dreams, and hallucinations. That is true renunciation. Giving up some money is not renunciation, extra money. Sharing some clothes is not renunciation, because if they are torn out, worn out, it's not renunciation. What is to be renounced is these concepts which are bothering us, these ideas which are blocks, obstacles to know our own nature. All right, when I give up these ideas, when I free from these notions, what is going to happen? I'll wake up from the sleep. I'll wake up from the sleep. From sleep to wakefulness, that's what comes. Then what happens? The true attainment of God, the real, the true nature of the divinity is realized, not an imagination, not any thought, not anything. The reality comes to our own experience. We go by hearsay. Some man comes and says, this is who Baba is. Another man comes and says, you know who Baba is? So someone tells, this is what Baba is. Someone asks you, do you know who he is? But how does it help me? If you tell me who he is, how am I to know? If you tell your experience, how am I to have my own experience? Therefore, the reality comes to experience when we give up all our imaginations and mental projections. All this said so far can be summed up in one sentence. In one sentence, after all, being a teacher, I will be trying to elaborate extensively as old habits thy heart. 48 years in teaching profession. Naturally will tempt me to speak extensively, though not necessary. What to do? So all that has been said till now can be summed up in one sentence. We have been till now, till this moment, till this second, we are in the thought of God. Thought of God is different from being God. Thought of God is different from being in God. Therefore, we are amusing ourselves, entertaining ourselves with the thought of God. But when once these externals, superimpositions, suppositions, hypotheses, fixes in their nature are given up, we'll truly see, experience our true nature. That's what being in God and be God, which is above the thought of God. One example, if a flower is kept there, I am not getting the smell. Something wrong with my nose? I see. I go to the ENT specialist. He says, nothing wrong with your nose. Yes, the nasal structure is good. Nostrils are good. Nothing wrong. You please go check up. I come back and see the flower. But I don't get any smell. Then I go very near. Then to my surprise, I discover it is a plastic flower. That it is an artificial flower. So I am not getting smell. Therefore, my friends, position, money, recognition, name, fame, these are all plastic flowers. They are not giving any fragrance. But we think we get it, but we are not getting it. Because the fragrance lies in, not from the flower, it is in the flower. It is not out of the flower. To enjoy the fragrance, I have to be a flower. I have to be a flower. Because flower and fragrance are not separate. Be a flower and do not expect fragrance from plastic flowers. The plastic flowers are artificial, worldly, mundane. That's what it is. All the modern civilization is full of artificial, synthetic, plastic in its nature. Wherever you go, even if you want to see some dance, you find laser lights disturbing. If you listen to some music, all electronics, da 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 da, the BP will shoot up, blood pressure. Because noise, we don't have any calmness. We don't find anything where there is quietude, calmness, silence. Therefore, the modern civilization, including video games, have not given any pleasure. Why? Because that is all synthetic, artificial in its nature. Therefore, we have got to be in search of the grass roots of our life. Where are the roots? If I look up, I don't find roots. I should look down. Where are they? In the soil. Without it, the whole edifice, the whole tree cannot stand up there. So modern man, all of us, have been cut off from the roots. Roots are within, which are responsible for the whole tree outside. Therefore, the roots are within, the bliss is within, the divinity is within. All the 65 volumes, such as I speaks, all 10 vahinis, all the 10 summer showers, speak of this only. The roots are in the ground. That bliss is within you, that you have to discover yourself. But no, sir. I may say, yes, I find bliss. I see the bliss within me. Very good. But that gets cut off. Something like power cut in India. Something like power cut in Andhra. Something like power cut in Puttaparthi. The newspapers say, we'll have power cut for 8 hours in villages hereafter. 8 hours of power cut abroad is unthinkable, unimaginable. 8 hours power cut abroad will solve population problem. Because multi-storied buildings, people get stuck up there. We can collect the bodies later. The whole life goes around the power supply. So what is happening? Power cut. My individual soul is not connected to the universal soul. The individual soul is not connected to the universal soul. It only means mic is here, but I have not connected to the switch. Mic is good, but it has not been connected to the main switch. The individual soul has got to be connected with the universal soul, which are one and the same, which are basically similar, which are fundamentally identical. So individual soul and universal soul, what Christian theology calls it holy communion, what Indian practice prescribes dhyana or meditation. Dhyana or meditation or holy communion is nothing but establishing connection, communion between the individual soul and the universal soul. To simplify it, I can be this way, see. Love is truth, but not thought. Love is not thought. It is existential reality. Truth is not thought. It is a reality. Peace is not thought. It is a reality. So, truth, peace, love, they are not. They have nothing to do with thoughts. You may think of love, but love is not thought. You may think of love, love is not thought. Therefore, to know the reality, to get into the roots, to get into the center of my being, to know the bliss within, I must get out of the thought. Because thought is not the reality. Bliss is not the thought. Truth, peace, love, they are not thoughts. They are existential. Bliss, existence. Baba says truth is God, but he never says truth is thought. He says love is God, he never says God is thought. So love is God, that's all. Love is not thought. Truth is God, that's all. Truth is not thought. Therefore, the thoughtlessness will help us to give up thoughts, to brush our thoughts, not with a deliberate attempt. Effortlessly, the only effort needed is to be effortless. The only word to be thoughtless is to be wordless. So this thoughtlessness will help us to reach that unattainable, unknowable. There are two words here, unattainable, unknowable. Yes, principalship, attainable. Vice chancellor position, attainable. Member of the parliament, attainable. Cabinet minister, attainable. Richness, attainable. These are all attainable. But God is not attainable. Why? You attain that what you do not have. You attain position because you don't have it. You attain money because you don't have it. But you are God, what is there to attain? What is there to attain? So God is unattainable from the point of thought. That's what I'm coming. I'm coming to that. So thought is an obstacle. So thought will make us know that God is unattainable. Because thought helps me to plan how to build the house, how many lights I need, three phase or two phase or no phase. And that's the thought, planning. Thought is planning. So thought is an obstacle. From the point of thought, God is unattainable. When thought is given up, you are there. Because you are God. And then there are two aspects here. Flower, Baba often gives this example. Flower is seen, fragrance is not seen. Mother is seen, her love is not seen. So one is visible, other is invisible. This invisible cannot be visible by thought. Thought will help you to experience the visible, but thoughtlessness will take you to invisible. So thought will take us to unknowable, unattainable, and invisible. It is not knowledge. It is not scholarship. It is the reality, one's own nature. Baba puts it, existence or easiness. Easiness, that is. We cannot say was. I cannot say will be. Was, will be. Past tense and future tense have no meaning in spirituality. We should not use the past and the future in spiritual science, because spiritual science is here and now. It was not then and there. It is here and now. So it is easiness, as Bhagavan puts it. Or existence. Or being. Or the center of the universe. Which is as much as the center of your individual life. Therefore, that reality is transcendental. Is transcendental to thoughts. Reality transcends the thoughts. That's why Baba necessarily speaks this. You are not the body. Body is a water bubble. You are the mind. Mind is the mad monkey, he says. But we think, why repeated, Swami, you heard number of times. Number of times, why repetition? We have not gone into the depth. You are not the mind means what? Thoughtlessness. Transcendental to thought. That's what it is. When Baba says you are not the mind, means be thoughtless. You are not the body. What does it mean? Don't have body identification. That's what it means. And further he says, you are not the body, you are not the mind, but you are God, you are conscience. You are conscience. So individual soul is conscience. Universal soul is consciousness. These are all the nomenclature, terms used by Baba. I am not capable of imagination. I am not competent to think along these lines. I do the job of a typical teacher. Read, reread, write, understand, digest, communicate. That's all. But let me also share with you a personal note, on a personal note. Seeing me talking like this, visiting every place, writing and talking and all that, my father made a remark, a personal note. I apologize to you for this personal note. He said, I really appreciate what you are doing, reading, writing, talking, sharing, good. And then my father said, I'll give you one example. What's that? It is the example of a spoon. With spoon, you distribute honey to everybody. Everyone sips that honey. Don't mind to have extra sip. One more sip. But those that take the sip of honey enjoy the taste. But the spoon does not know the taste. Spoon does not know the taste. So he warned me, don't be a spoon. Don't be a spoon. But I think I'm still a spoon. I'm still a spoon. The life is passing by. Decades have been completed in the spiritual journey. Well, I don't think that I would live that long as I lived. But the real nectar, the taste of the divinity, that non-dual experience, the transcendental experience, is still being theoretical, is still being academic. I dare not make a claim. But then what am I doing? Why should I do it? It's only self-reminder. It's only self-reminder. It's only a kind of meditation. When I speak on that, I cannot keep my mind in the market. I cannot allow my mind to go to the stores. Just one joke I made with my friends yesterday. It's not derogatory, but I'm critical. We find people running immediately after bhajan in the evening for meditation. Very fast. Then I said, Anil Kumar, did you notice that? I said, all that run there for meditation are foreigners. They run to the meditation hall. All those that run to the stores there are from India. They are our brothers. We also run, but we run to the stores. But these foreigners run to the mandir. I am sure Baba above will be very happy and bless them. We are not running to a theater. We are not running to buy a ticket to watch cricket match. No. We are running to have a seat in mandir for meditation. One day, the former editor Sanatana Sarathi was talking to Swami. He saw boys running. Narasimhan saw boys running. There in Bangalore, the steps are made up of marbles. They are just washed. Narasimhan is very worried that they may slip. And Narasimhan also is worried because running is an act of indiscipline. So he told Swami, "Swami, our boys are running like that. What signals they send to devotees? Is it not indiscipline?" That's what he said. Swami said, "Correct, correct, Narasimhan, correct. Boys may fall, you know. I understand. Tell them, tell them." He allowed him to say that same thing. "Then sit down," he said. "Anil Kumar, you get up." Then he started discourse. Boys in the world, they run to the theater. Boys in other institutions run and run for a cricket match, to see a film actress, to see a heroine, to clubs. But boys run for God only in Prashanthalam and Bangalore. Running elsewhere is mundane, worldly. But running towards God is meditation, that's what he said. Is meditation. Friends, we feel like sharing these things with each other, particularly now, to remind ourselves what our good God said on several occasions. Constant reminder is necessary. Wow! Swami says this. You see all that. You see everybody. You look at everybody. The one who looks, the one who hears, the one who touches, the one who smells, the one who tastes. I taste, I see, is one I. But the real I is inside. The one I that goes on appreciating others, that goes on bloating in ego, that relishes flattery and delicious hypocrisy, is I, one I, idiotic, stupid, psychological I. But the true I is within, which is non-dual, which is spiritual, which is deathless, which is immortal, which is nectarine. This true I within is the real I, which is the very same cosmic I, which is the very same universal I. That's what Baba says. But then why don't I see? Why don't I experience? Because my job has been only onlooker, watching, that's all. I don't watch the real witness. The one who watches is the watchman. But the one who witnesses inside is the spirit or consciousness. So Baba wants us to experience that real being, the very consciousness within us, not being an onlooker, a spectator. Outer I is a spectator. Outer I is only a watcher, while the inner I is the witness. The outer I is ego, psychological, with a name and a form, while the inner I is nameless, formless, non-dual, transcendental reality. That's what Swami says. So instead of saying, I have seen, know the seer, know the knower, hear the hearer, experience the experiencer. That is the reality, as Baba always says. Before I get into some other area, let me tell you this point, my friends. We say that boy is not sufficiently mature enough to say this. That man is not mature enough. He is not the one of maturity. We use this word, maturity. What is maturity? 10 years of experience in the office, 20 years of experience. What is maturity? At this age, am I mature enough? Boys, postgraduate students, are they mature enough? What is maturity? In our mind, maturity is age. Maturity is personality. Maturity is experience. Maturity is exposure. Maturity is knowledge. That is maturity, what we think. Exactly speaking, in spiritual parlance, is immaturity. We have not been yet matured enough to know that we are immature. So we should be mature enough to know that we are immature. We are not mature, we are immature. Why? What is maturity? Maturity is giving up the mind. Giving up the mind. Transcending the mind. Above the mind. That's what true maturity is. Swami, would you give me an example? If Baba is accepted as divine, as our divine master, it is for this simple reason. He makes the toughest things expressed in the simplest way possible. But our ego wants complication. More complicated, more imagination. We think we are promoted. No. We are closer to mental hospital. God simplifies while man amplifies. God simplifies while man complicates. Let not complicate, amplify. Baba puts maturity in the simplest style. Simple example. It seems a child is crying. A child. Somebody went, why do you cry, dear? What? The child says, I am playing with a doll. And the doll, the toy with which I am playing, is broken to pieces. Therefore I am crying. Oh, I see. The child is crying because of immaturity. Toy, after all, is a toy. One need not cry for it. You can get another toy. As you play, it is sure to break. When it breaks, it is not a life and death problem. Child is crying out of immaturity. Then we meet another old man. He is very sad with a long Shakespeare face. And why are you serious? I could not get what I wanted. I could not attain what I wanted. I could not be that what I expected. Now I am unhappy. That elderly man, old man, is as much a child as a child who cries for the toy that is broken. Meaningless. There is no point in crying for my past. I cannot say that I got very low marks in my SLC class, 12th class. Mathematics, I was very, very poor, right from the cradle, right from the swing. Mathematics is enough to make me shiver in my shoe. So So I got 82 in English, 12th class, 82. 42 in mathematics. Even that 42, I think God must have given. I don't remember to have solved any problem in the question paper. Half, 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 half like that. And my grandfather asked me, show me the answers, how many questions, problems you solved, how many marks. I said, there's no time to note the answers. The invigilator took me the paper. So 42 is 100% to my standard. Whereas in English, 82. Telugu, 75. Science, all good. Mathematics is there. To me, it's like that. Therefore, my friends, here the very, very funny thing is, what is one of saying, I did not get good marks in my 12th class, is activated. You did your 10th class also in 1957. Why do you want to cry now? Oh, I cannot appear for exemption again. Past is past. So old man crying is as much ridiculous, silly, as a child crying for a toy. Then we see a young man. He is also not happy. And why? Will I get seat in the medical college or not? Will I get visa to go to US or not? That again a worry. It is also silly. Try, you may get it or not. The future is the cause. He is as much a child crying for the breaking of the toy. So child is immature. Elderly man is immature. Youngster is immature. Child is immature for the toy that is broken. A senior man is immature because he is lamenting for the past. A youngster is immature because of meaningless worry of the future which is yet to come. Therefore, true maturity is to grow beyond the mind. True maturity is the transcendental state of the mind. Baba, how am I to know these things? How am I to experience these things? Who will tell me these things? It is easy to tell. Go to the temple. Go around Ganesha 108 times, you'll have a birth in heaven. Birth is guaranteed, seat guaranteed, just 108 times. Then why should saints do penance for hundreds and thousands of years? Can't they just go 108 times? Easy. Or you can say, do some vratam or something. You are sure to be liberated. But you will be liberated from the money you have. That liberation I do not know. So, I am not condemning them. They are so okay. That whatever we do with the mind, whatever we do with the body, they may be sacred acts, but not spiritual in its nature. So, spiritual approach is different from ritualistic approach. Ritualistic approach is their preparation to spiritual direction. We cannot stop here. Therefore, my friends, we can really understand with Baba's grace only. These things we can understand, we can practice. Someday or other, some life or other, realize with His grace only. Swami, don't I have Your grace? Don't I have Your grace? Should I consult somebody? Do I need any legal assistance to know that I have Your grace or not? Baba says, My grace comes to your experience. You will never question whether you have grace or not. It comes to your experience. How, Swami? Is my appetite, hunger, satiated? Have I eaten enough? How can I say? You will know. You have eaten already 3 laddus. Are they enough? How can I say? Eat 3 more if you can. You will know how much you have eaten. Therefore, Swami's grace comes to our experience. In the process, He may punish and protect. Punish and protect. Sikshistadu, rakshistadu. Sikshistadu, rakshistadu. Punish and protect. What punish? Suddenly my promotion is done, kept in abeyance. Then I said, we'll ask, where is Puttaparthi? Let me go. Our daughter is to be married and true alliance could not be obtained till now. Let me go to Lord Venkateshwara, offer him some hair now, so that he'll send somebody. Some problem, health problem, family problem, financial problem, will certainly take us to him. 99.9% of theists, of devotees, of all gods, of all gurus, majority are because of some problem or other. So that problem, though is a punishment, but it is promotion. Punishment is not punishment, it is promotion. I have come with a problem to Baba, that problem is solved, but I hang on to Baba now. It is not something like a heater. You put it on when you need it. It's not that. It's not gas stove. You put it only to heat. It's not like that. I come to Swami for help. I got the help. But I hold on to Him. Now is that punishment? No. The punishment is a promotion. Is a promotion. It's protection. Sikshinchi rakshistadu. Then what happens? In this protected state, in this promoted state, when we are comfortable, now come some more punishments. People at home will not call you, come back, come back. Others in the society, why there, why there, why there? Others will say, what is there, what is there? Why there? What is there? Come back. It is again punishment. So, from punishment to protection, from protection to punishment. Sikshinchi, rakshinchi, rakshinchi, sikshinchi. Again problems. Finally he says, kshaminchi, rakshinchi. The third stage, kshaminchi, He will forgive you and protect you. So 3 states, punishment takes us to promotion, protection, and that in that settled state when everything is well, Baba puts us to tests, because Baba said, test is my taste. What to do? Even that, well, I have better taste of Andhra pickles, but Baba's taste is test. Not pickles, what to do? So, He protects and again tests, punishment. Finally He says, kshaminchi rakshistanu. I forgive you and protect you. Forgiveness and eternal protection in the spiritual bosom, under the spiritual umbrella, under the spiritual canopy, eternal protection. Then Swami, why doubt? Why I doubt you? Why I doubt? Why these doubts? Why this discussion? Why these satsangs? Why these deliberations? Why my mind is bothering me, Swami? Tell me why all this? Now Baba says this, see that? Are, are, are. He is a guru of gurus, the eternal guru. Is that a certificate that I am giving? Out of joy I am telling. which is your own impression. See, wonderful, a golden Swami. When we have got Swami the gold, we have got Swami the diamond, but we run after tinsels, trash, pebbles, stones. What a pity it is. There cannot be greater tragedy, or worst of the tragedies that could happen in our life. If a stone is to attract us, leaving the diamond. If a pebble is to attract us, leaving the gold behind. See, what a wonderful comparison he gives. Why doubt? Swami says this. When you are close to the mirror, you can see yourself clearly. When you are far from the mirror, the picture, your image, your reflection is not clear. Clarity of the, you say resolution? The photographers use this word, resolution. When I first heard this word from a cameraman, photographer, resolution, it looked funny to me. What resolution that camera can make when a human being is not able to resolve and take a resolution? That camera can take resolution. Then camera must be superior to me. I'm inferior because I could not resolve till now. So Baba says now, it is not the mistake of the reflection. It is not my mistake. What is to be done is, I should go close to the mirror. When I go close to the mirror, I can see the picture clear. Because I'm away, the picture is not clear. So come closer to the mirror, then you can see very, very clear. Mahasamadhi, such a Sai Divya Sannidhi is that mirror. When we come close to that, we can see our picture clearly, our own self very clearly. Just a couple of days ago, a boy could receive the cloth spread on Samadhi as a gift from one of the trustees. And he took that cloth, silk cloth, and wrapped it around his back, something like shawl, stood in front of Samadhi. His legs started trembling, hands started shaking, highly sweating. It took some time for him to be normal. Later people asked him, what happened to you? You got the rare gift of the cloth. Then the boy said, I saw Baba there. I saw Swami there. Therefore I started shivering. When Swami is there, why should you shiver? You should jump in joy. No, sir. I do Samadhi service every day. I keep flowers there. I keep Samadhi. I looked at Samadhi, as a structure of cement, sand and mortar. It's just a structure, an infrastructure, a material structure. But when I see Baba there, naturally I started shaking myself. Others don't shake because they expect Swami. All those that go there do namaskar because they see Swami. Whereas this fellow who decorates, who cleans, thinks that it is only structure of cement and mortar. So to be near is a curse. It's not a boon. Go to any temple. The priest will look at the coins that you put there. Chief priest. Whereas you look at God. Swami, you have given me money. The priest thinks, you give me money. When I say he gave me money, the priest thinks you give me, let the devotee give. So it is not nearness that's very important. Samadhi should give us the feeling of sannidhi. That should give us that proximity. Second example, Baba said, when you are moving in the train, when you travel by train, you find the trees, mountains running. They're running. Are they running? No. You are running. They are not running. A tree is there only. The train is running, you are going, therefore trees are running. Mountain, no. Similarly, as my mind is wavering, as my mind is unsteady, as my mind lost its concentration, as mind has no focused attention, it is running. And think that the tree is running. Think that Baba is not looking at me. That Baba's grace is not on me. No, no, it is always, you are running, what can I do? You are running away. So Swami says, it is always there. Third example, he gives that of a magnet. Magnet attracts all iron pieces. But one iron piece is not attracted. Darshan line, 20th row, or 25th row, last line. And that man at the behind is feeling, Swami is not attracting me. The man in first line, Swami avoids him. Last line man feels that he is avoided. First line man feels that he is not looking at him. Both are equally backward classes. I and you are one is applicable here. May not be spiritually. Then Baba says, first line people think that I am avoiding them. The last line people think that they have no grace. Both are equally bad. Both are equally ignorant children. Please understand this. What? There is a lot of sunlight outside. Sunlight. But what you have to do is open the windows, open the doors so that light will. But you have closed your doors. Main door is closed, windows are closed, light. Light is outside, open the door. So I am there, open the heart, doors of your heart. Knock, it shall be opened, says the Holy Bible. Seek, you shall find. Knock, it shall be opened. Hear, you will hear. See, you will see. So you are not doing it. And still you blame me, says Swami. So you are an iron piece, but still you feel that you are not attracted. It is not my fault. That iron piece is covered by dust. Iron piece is dusted and rusted, roasted. So it is not attracted. So remove the dust, remove the rust, so that it will be attracted by the iron. What is the dust? What is the rust? That is the mind. That is the thought. When once it is gone, it can be drawn towards me. We meet again. Thank you very much for your gracious presence. This morning thought, this morning's contemplation has been a travel together, a journey together, sharing the knowledge that Baba has given us. There is no question of anyone knowing more than the other, because knowledge is obstacle. There is no question of one experiencing more than the other, because experience is not important. Experiencer is important. So, we being the same, at the very center of our life, at the very being of our life, I wanted to share this much of information that I collected from Sai literature. Thank you for your time, for being here. I pray from the bottom of my heart that Baba should help us to elevate our souls, to help in establishing connection with the super cosmic soul, such that we understand all are one. My dear son, be alike to everyone. That we will experience that oneness in this life itself, and seek His divine presence forever and evermore. Sai Ram. Thank you very much. Om Asato Ma Sadhamaya Soma Yodhirgamaya Mrutyorma Amrutangamaya Om Samasta Loka Sukhino Samasta Loka Sukhino Bhavantu Samasta Loka Sukhino Bhavantu
And when we walk